Well, I'm glad you're here tonight. You can be seated. Let me just tell you a couple of stories before I get too into things. And I'm going to tell you about one of my heroes. A lot of my heroes I keep to myself because I just want people to let Jesus be their only singular hero. But there's a great man of God named Charles Simeon. And he was born about 1760, I think. Yeah, he was born right around 1760. He went to Oxford University when the Methodist movement was really strong. He was in the Anglican Church, and he didn't know really anything about God and really know anything about Jesus beyond just his basic catechism that he had gone through in the Anglican Church, being baptized as a baby. And they told him, well, before you could graduate, you got to take communion three times. That's the way it used to be in these schools, you know. They were Christian schools. And so, he began to agonize over communion. My goodness, what am I going to do? I'll take communion. He didn't know Jesus. He didn't have a walk with Christ Jesus. So, being the diligent soul that he was and not taking things for granted and just doing it superfluously, foolishly, he began to study. What does it mean? And he bought all the books and he made himself sick, fasting and praying and reading. And all he did is after a number of weeks, he felt worse because he couldn't find any peace with God. There was no kind of a concept for him to find peace with God, to get right with God. And in the midst of the throes of all of this, the Lord spoke to him in the night and said, and just spoke to him and let him see a sacrificial lamb in the Old Testament. As a person came and laid its hands upon it and confessed its sins, and its sins was imparted to the Lamb, he woke up and thought, you mean all I have to do is put my hands upon his holy head to place my sins upon his holy being? To heap up all my wrongdoings upon his holy brow? And they should all be transferred from me to him, and I should go free? And that moment, he breathed in the peace of the living God. He says, I breathed in the peace of the living God. He became a radical preacher that everybody despised. As he graduated from Oxford, he was appointed to one of the great universities, actually campus university at Cambridge. And everybody despised him because he came with such a fiery message of fellowship and relationship with God, that there was a place to live in and walk in with God of complete abandonment where he alone would live. And no one could relate to him. So at that time you could go into your pew and you could lock your aisle because they had swinging doors. And everybody would come in, a few people would come in and they would lock their doors. So if the visitors came, they wouldn't be able to have any place to be seated, and they boycotted him because it was appointed. He had an appointed position. They didn't have to cooperate, but he had an appointed position from the university. There was nothing anyone could do. And so he'd buy up chairs at his own expense, put them in the aisles, and the elders would come in and throw them all out. And there was really nothing he could do, and they would organize Sunday school meetings of different types, Greek class and other classes, while he was preaching, they would pull the people who would come out of the meeting, so he would only have a couple of people there. And here he was distilling this great revelation and insights of heaven that speak one of the loudest commentary works on the entirety of the Bible today, heads and shoulders above most all other commentators. Think about this. They would throw bricks in the open windows and shout out obscenities at him while he was preaching. This is the Christian folks. Everyone was so embarrassed at him and ashamed of his radical behavior. No one wanted to be seen with him. He had no friends. Everybody disdained him. Ultimately, as time went on, he began to take those at Cambridge who are in the religious department who wanted to learn about how to get a hold of God and how to minister the things of the Word, because he taught them about illumination in the Spirit, how to understand the Word of God by the Spirit. And then as time went on, they came to be called Sims because his name was Simeon. And they became a whole new breed of preachers. And they had many opportunities to do different things, but he stayed there for 50 years. He died there in that pulpit. But after his death, his ministry, I mean, I'm going to tell you right today, there was things I went and looked at Hore Homiletica. He's the one who did all the Hore Homiletica, which is a huge volume of work on the Bible. It is one of the most outstanding works of the 1700s that anybody can find. How that was born in a person's life who was willing to walk alone with Jesus, who was willing to be persecuted, ridiculed, shut out. But he didn't really need it. He had all the popularity before he found out that he could transfer his sins upon the brow of Jesus. He had all the popularity before all of a sudden he had communion. He took communion in a heart of consecration and found a glorious holy union with the living God. But then he became so unique and he became so different, nobody could tolerate him. It's not right for such men to live. I mean, that's kind of the reputation that many of the people of God, you know, obtained. And this wonderful glory of walking out this faith with the Lord Jesus. You heard the crowds and the masses say, "Away with them, for it's not right that such men should live." Same kind of way that they treated Jesus. And but I'm telling you, there is a glory and a power. There was none of those other preachers that in Cambridge University whose names are known to this day. None of those university professors, none of the people with all the reputations of men are known today. But Charles Simeon, if you're a preacher and you have any kind of commitment to the study of God's word, everybody knows his name. And the things that God revealed to him and showed to him, it causes faith to fill the hearts of everybody who reads the writings that he was taught along with Jesus. And I'm just so earnest to see you get along with Jesus and you be taught the writings. Because he retains all revelation himself. I don't care how intelligent you are, you can't get it till he shows you. And when he shows you, then you can begin to move in something that goes beyond a human response. You know, everybody can believe or can say that they believe, but when all of a sudden you have to take all that you know within the trust of your own human self and your own human strength and do away with it and throw all your cares upon him, that's where it all begins to come apart. And I want you to open your Bibles with me, and I want to show you a verse of scripture that I hope that every one of you can come to deal with in a very effective way. And as you do, God will show you how to move with the Holy Ghost. He'll show you how to move in the realms of faith. He'll show you how to move in the realms of the Spirit, so that everything that belongs to God and his power and his works and his authority over all darkness, you'll be able to function in it. There won't be anything be able to hurt you or harm you. Satan won't be able to access you or touch you. God will show you how to hate evil and love righteousness. He will fill you with the oil of gladness above all other people. You will find out heaven's reality comes and fills your soul. All shame will leave you. You will find yourself one with God and won't just be confessing something that you haven't really had the explosion of expression in your heart to really realize and believe. You know, there are so many people, they're just willing to pretend. You know, but there's other people that won't. They won't pretend. They've got to have what God said. Yeah. They've got to do it right. And those are the people that are seeking God in truth. And we want you to be truth seekers. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We want you to be seeking God with all your heart, not some of it. Hallelujah. You know, God's just not some casual opportunity that you have to drop in and check in every once in a while. I mean, God is the living God. He's an all-powerful God who's willing to condescend to become your lamb, your sacrifice, your savior, the means by which all of your sins can be done away because you're able to take them and transfer them on to him and go free. This privilege of being able to know the Son of God, the only begotten Son who brings us to the Father, and there's no way to come to God the Father but by the Son. This wonderful love of God that has been shed abroad in our hearts so that we can know him, so that we can walk in all of his blessings, that we can walk in divine health, we can walk in divine strength, I'm telling you right now, when you walk in divine strength, I'm telling you right now, you're walking all pleasing. You're walking pleasing unto God. See, those that are in the flesh and that rely upon human ability, they can't please God. And that's where the whole breakdown comes. That's where God's whole interest is. That's where the whole challenge is, because constantly we confront things that causes us to have the same kind of response that a rock has to gravity. To go and rely upon our own self to figure it out, to work it out, to help God out. I've watched over and again where the power of God comes on people, the anointing comes on people. I'll tell you, you'll hear me say it over and again. Leave them alone. Don't touch them. You can touch somebody who hasn't had the power of God come on them yet. You can pray them through. But don't touch somebody who has. Don't, because you bring them right out of it. Because what happens is usually what's going on is people come and they try to help. They want to help. They want to console. And then what's happened is a transference of the human, literally as it were, comes. And the glory of the power of God is shut down. People, we got to understand that one of the biggest things that we are challenged with is God doesn't need any help here. He wants to own people who know how to listen to Him, speak when He says speak, move when He says move, walk when He says walk, stop when He says stop. Come on. He's trying to teach us how to rely upon Him, especially in those things that are most important to us, in which we actually see or define as the means by which we exist. You define food as the means by which you exist. You define safety and shelter and other things as the means by which you exist. That if you do not have them, you do not have a good existence. And all of that is a falsehood. And Jesus tried to express it in Matthew chapter 6 and said, as long as you're caught up in that, you're never going to move with me in the realms of my kingdom. You got to lay all of that aside. You got to cast all of that aside. You got to cast all your care upon God, Paul said later, because He cares for you. Casting all your care upon Him, because everyone who will walk before Him broken and humble and submitted to Him, He's promised to empower us, to give to us everything that we have need of. And that is that's where it all comes apart. That's where it really all comes apart. But you know what the beautiful thing of it is God is devoted to developing us in faith. But you need to be developed. And you're not going to be developed until some point in time you take risk. And you go beyond yourself. And then, you know, as we're just seeking Him, He shows us how to keep our hands off stuff. He shows us how to just stand still and behold the mighty power of God, and behold His salvation. Just to stand still and watch what He will do. Just forget about your own weapons, raise your hands, and just start worshiping Him. I found that that's one of the most glorious ways to have breakthrough, is that when all this stuff is going on, I just lift my hands and just start worshiping the Lord. When all the problems and all the issues, Father will never speak to me and the complexities of my thinking. You know, a lot of times people, they'll get in a situation where a little bit of fear comes in, a little bit of pressure comes in, and then they try to come up with a decision. That will always be something terribly human, or even worse, demonic. God will never speak that way. You'll never hear Him in crisis like that. You got to learn how to be still and know that He is God. Shut everything else out. Worship and praise Him. Say, Lord, whether we live or whether we die, we're just going to obey You and do what You say, because we know that You're God. Amen. And we're willing to, you're willing to take a risk on it? I'll tell you right now, you're risking whether you know it or not. Whether you go all the way or not, you're risking everything. Because reality of it is, there's no other means of salvation but by the power and the name of Jesus Christ. And unless you're willing to put your trust in Him, I mean, your eternity is just absolutely terrible. It couldn't be described to be any worse. So why don't you just go ahead and go all the way with Him tonight and just begin to understand that you can't please God so long as you're walking in human ability. The only way you can please God is to walk in the Spirit. And you know, we have an opportunity. Enoch walked with God. You and I get to walk with God. We can walk with God in the Spirit. He's going to teach us how that everything that we do and the way we do it is absolutely and totally wrong. People ask me, am I a motivational speaker? I say, I'm a demotivational speaker. I'm going to demotivate you. I'm going to teach you why you should hate your life in this world. Amen. That's not popular. I felt good till I came to the meeting. And then I had to listen to somebody tell me and convince me why I needed to lose my life so that I could find it. Oh, yeah. That goes cross-grained to everything that you've been trained to believe and think and do. in general, and those of you who've been around me for a long time, some of you just learned to tolerate it. And I pray in the name of Jesus that it won't be a toleration anymore. It will be, instead of an abdication of your responsibility in God, you'll lay hold on this eternal life and you learn that you're going to walk in the Holy Ghost, and that means you're not in charge anymore. God is amazing how patient He is with all of us hard-headed people. He's so patient. You're not in charge anymore. You don't get to do it your own way. You don't argue with God. I'm certain that many Christians today, if God stood before them and said, don't do that, they would stand there and argue with Him or give Him that knowing little smile that they know better than what He knows, or that He just doesn't really understand what happened. And they just wait for Him to be quiet so they can give their explanation. You're never going to be able to move forward in God. He'll love you, bless your darling heart. But you'll never know the power of the overcomer. You'll never know what it means to live this victorious life. You'll never understand what it means to walk in the authority that He has given to us to be His sons, to be sons of God. I mean, there cannot be a greater position, a greater opportunity than to walk around with that kind of authority. As many as will believe upon His name. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You know, when we pray for people, we don't look to ourselves and wonder if we got the goods. We just learn how to flow over in the, learn how to get over in the anointing, flow in the Spirit. That's it. I mean, I'm sure that most of you, there's had a time where you've just been caught away, captivated, just ecstasy, just caught away in God. Everybody ever felt that and feel that? You just caught away. Just caught away. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. It's a wonderful realm. That's what I always do. I don't just do that every once in a while. In fact, I don't even sing till I feel that. I don't even sing. I'd much less preach. I don't pray till I feel that. I've learned how to give myself over to the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. And He's a very real and living God that brings to with Him all of the glory, all of the holy emotions that Father has in His joy unspeakable, and all that He has in His love that goes beyond all knowledge. People think this is fictional. No, this is reality. You're just going to have to break free of whatever it is that you, the life you've been living. Jesus said, you lose your life and you can have my life. You can have my life. But the whole concept of people denying themselves, I mean, you start telling people and convincing people why they needed to deny themselves, and then you begin to define it, then everybody's all upset saying, what are you talking about? But you're saying this thing about me, you're saying that I'm this or I'm that, and become all defensive. One way or the other, men will argue in their minds as God the Holy Spirit teaches us or attempts to teach us how to function in the divine. So tonight, I just pray that you're willing to learn how to be an ecstatic in God. And that's what it literally means to be those people who are prophets and who prophesy. And God's made us all prophets to prophesy, poured out a spirit of prophecy upon all flesh, so we can all be ecstatics. I mean, that's just caught away in a realm of ecstasy. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I tell you right now, be caught away in a realm of ecstasy gets you through any troubling, opposing situations. It will. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
It truly will. Hallelujah. It truly will. Praise God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You know, with those that are in flesh cannot please God, but praise God, we're not in the flesh, but in the Spirit. But the Lord defines what it means to be in the Holy Ghost. And of course, you know, I'm quoting Romans 8 and verse 9. He defines that we're to be led by the Spirit, that we're walking the Spirit, that we're not to walk in any kind of fear anymore. We're not in this prison of fear, under the bondage of fear anymore. But He's sent forth the Spirit of His Son into our hearts, crying out, God is my dad, crying out, Abba, Father. And so I want you to look here at this verse of Scripture with me here in Matthew chapter 14. Hallelujah. In verse 31. And the Lord says, looks at Peter and says, oh, you of little faith, why did you doubt? So here it is. He's walking in a realm. I mean, you think about it. If you took one step on the water, you'd think that you should have a plaque made for you, and it should be your testimony for the rest of your life. I walked one step on the water. And I believe that Peter took more than one step. He was walking on the water, going to Jesus. People should think, well, my goodness, I did it. I have arrived. I stepped over in with the Master into a place of authority and dominion over all the physical realm. Think about it. And the Lord's stoked. He's saying, you know what he's saying? He's saying, this is beautiful. Somebody gets it. Somebody's got it. Somebody's actually moving with me. Somebody's captivated with me and moving with me. And so as soon as that all got interrupted, because what happened was Peter became overwhelmed by his circumstance, because he's like, suddenly he was captivated by Jesus, raptured in the realm of the heavenly, and there in that place he could do anything. But all of a sudden he became aware of his circumstances and said, what am I doing out here? He saw because of the wave and the boisterous wind, he was good. He was so captivated by Jesus. Think about it. At one moment, they thought they were going to die because of the storm, the violence of the storm. The next moment, they're afraid because they see this ghost come walking on the water. Jesus says, fear not, it's me. They're going, you got to be kidding me. Peter's like captivated, going, what? That's you? It is you. Bid me come, because I understood the authority of the word. He's captivated. He's in the heavenly realm. He got a glimpse of heaven. And when he got a glimpse of heaven, he was then carried away over into a heavenly realm that freed him of all the earthly restraints. Suddenly, in connection with heavenly realm, he can function in the heavenly realm. And there he goes, walking on the water. Jesus looks at him and goes, why? And then, but when he was overwhelmed by circumstances, Jesus says, you little faith. He didn't say, hey, Peter, good job, man. High five. You did well. I can't believe it. It's like you, first time out, you like took 10 steps. Jesus said, bummer. He said, bummer, man. You blew it. That's what he said. You blew it. I mean, come on, listen to me. Because everybody wants a trophy and a reward for failure. That even right, dear friend of mine, he just pulled his son out of school. I mean, because he's a champion, he's a hero in the faith, Philip Smithhurst, and what God is doing through him all throughout the nations of the earth right now. And his son was in school and he was on a soccer team, and he was like on a C-level soccer team, and that C-level soccer team was the worst in the whole of the, you know, their division, you know. And so at the end of the thing, they gave his son, everybody, they're losers, the worst losers, and they gave them all trophies. And so Philip came and took the trophy away from his son and said, son, we don't get trophies for failure. I don't care what those idiots are telling you, we're not participating. You get trophies for winning. That's it. Now, right now, because now we're all trying to be, we're trying to achieve the highest standards of humanism. We're trying to achieve the highest standards of nihilism. We're trying to achieve the highest standards of everything that is contrary to the ways of God. And it's time that we say, wait a minute, do I really want to be in this realm? Do I really want to hang out with these folks that are really, they're mental cases. Huh? Come on. Just think about it. Let me just outline it for you. Huh? You know, come on, right? Are you listening to me? I don't want to go into the details of it because I'm loaded up with some really good ones to insult the flesh. I am asking God to make me a perfect example and orator when it comes to just ridiculing the self realm to make you disdain it. To say, you know what? I don't even want to be in this category anymore. I don't even want to be in the realm of humanity anymore. I've gotten an opportunity to exchange my life. And you're never going to exchange it until you hate your life in this world. I mean, Jesus said, unless you hate father and mother and brother and sister and all your possessions, you can't have me. That's what he said. And nobody gets that.
Very few people get that.
But it's actually something very good to get. And you know, reality of it is the Lord wants to bring us into His love. He wants to bring us into His glory so we can really love people, so that we can really love our father and our mother and our brother and our sister. But so long as we're trying to do it and we're just trying to rationalize it and reason it and do it out of our own human ability, out of our own strength, relying upon our own efforts, we can't please God. Because it's going to be far, far beneath anything that truly is real. True love, true joy, true peace, true life. So the Lord says, listen, I want you to put a big X on everything that you think you know about life. And let me come here and let me completely eliminate that. Let me destroy that. Can I destroy that?
Yes.
Destroy it. Yeah, I want to crucify it. I want it to be buried by baptism and my death. And I want to raise you up anew to be just like me.
Yes.
So I want to redefine your life for you. And people are looking at you like cross-eyed, wondering, what on earth are you talking about now? We're talking about heaven. We're talking about a brand new way of existence. We're talking about you no longer holding on to all the things that you've learned. Now you're going to unlearn them. Hallelujah. You're going to be taught by the Word of God. You're going to learn how to trust God. You're going to learn how to move with Him. You're going to learn how to walk in His laws, His divine orders, His spiritual laws of life. It cannot be your way. I know that you think that you're so special to the Lord, but you're not that special in that sense. You're very special to Him in the sense that He loves you so much that He gave His life for you, but you're not so special to Him that He's going to change the way He does things to accommodate the way that you think. Understand that. You're just not that special. Nobody is. And I'm so happy, because then otherwise the Lord would constantly be changing. And you know, who wants God to be like another man? Because who, you know, come on, I've discovered a long time ago that if you put your trust in man, you're going to be disappointed. Huh? Jesus entrusted Himself to no man because He knew what was in man. And what was in man is just very flighty, changing. Love you today, hate you tomorrow. As long as I don't know too much about you, I'll like you. But as soon as I find out something about you, and I'm sure it won't take long, that doesn't meet to my standards, which are very pathetic to begin with, I won't like you anymore. Because our standards are human standards. It's pathetic. Okay, what does that look like? Is that really immutable? Is that unchangeable? Does that need to grow? Does that need to develop? My goodness, it doesn't even have a chance. It needs to be destroyed. It needs to be done away with. If you lose your life, you can have it. If you hang on to your life, you're going to lose it. And this is the challenge that we have before us. God wants to teach us how no longer to rely upon ourselves. He wants us to teach us really how to believe Him. As many as believe Him, anyone who would believe Him, these works that He did shall they do also, and greater works. But as soon as Papa gets us into a place where He's trying to change us, we retreat to our own human ability, because we're going to rely upon those things that we think we can control. And in reality, you can't control nothing. Not really. You're just living out a gift that God has given to all men, all flesh. You've got breath coming in and out of your nostrils that He breathed into man.
Amen.
He causes His sun to shine upon the just and the unjust. He causes rain to fall upon the righteous and the wicked. He's poured out His Spirit upon all flesh. And all flesh isn't deserved. Are you listening to me? Because some of you don't even get it. I mean, listen, He's poured out His Spirit upon all flesh, not just some, everybody. You think about it. The blood of Jesus was shed not for our sins only, but also for the sins of the whole world. People are living in a divine opportunity of the grace and the mercy of God, and even those who are supposed to be closest to Him are reluctant to go all the way with Him. Jesus is trying to train the disciples. He says He doesn't give, you know, Peter a high five for a good try and a good effort, and you know, to really get out there and just, you know, take him into the boat and use him as an example to just chastise the rest of the disciples. You guys, you didn't even move, you sat around in here. Look at Peter, he got out here. No, he just dealt with the program as it really was. The Lord tells us right here in this verse of scripture, if you won't doubt, you can walk on the water. But you're going to have to get weaned of the NyQuil first. And I can go through the list of the things that people put their trust in. Are you hearing me?
Yes.
Do you know that the Holy Spirit has come here tonight to train you how to function in the Holy Ghost?
Yes.
Listen, I tell you right now, everywhere we go, you know, just like this morning, we'll begin to minister and people begin to fall out under the power of God everywhere we go. And we understand the movings of the Spirit of the Lord because of the function of the operation of the anointing when we walk in the laws of the Spirit. And our desire is that same thing will happen in your life.
Amen.
That you just won't be finding yourself relying upon trying to communicate the things that no man can get without the authority of heaven, without the glory of the Holy Ghost coming. Huh? Eyes not seen, ears not heard, neither has it entered into the heart of men the things that God has prepared for those that love Him. It's impossible for the natural mind to even begin to comprehend what God wants to do. But He wants, and He comes for the purpose of revealing them by the Holy Spirit, by the moving of the power of God. So listen to me. You've got to stop doing it your way. And it's just always at this point in time, we're always up against this. We're always up against this thing. Here we are wanting to train God's people. Praise God for everything that was done. I mean, that was awesome to see, you know, people, you know, leading the charge and people following in and helping yesterday. See so many people gathered in to this place to come and have an introduction to Jesus, just to have you bless them. But I'm going to tell you right now, Father wants to take that to a place in our life where that the power of God and the authority of heaven functions through us with the richness of the person of Jesus.
Yes.
So that what's going on are the works of Jesus.
Yes.
What's going on are the exploits of heaven.
Yes.
So that when you touch somebody, you're not touching them in human compassion.
Right.
Because human compassion will cause you to actually miss divine compassion.
Yes.
Human compassion will lead you this way. Divine compassion will lead you this way. Human compassion, all you're going to get is a handshake, a hug, a kiss, and a loaf of bread. Huh? Divine compassion, heaven's going to come and flood your soul, and the power and the authority of God is going to transform you and change you. Father has come with the Word. Father came to us when He sent His only begotten Son, the living and the eternal Word, to show the disciples that were with Him and to show us today, as we read the Word, how to move and function in the realms of the Spirit. He became the revelation. He became the definition. He became the declaration. He became the instructor. And as He's instructing Peter, He said, Peter, I want you to be able to get this. I want you to understand how to master the entirety of the physical realm. You cannot doubt. You cannot continue in a realm of little faith. A realm of little faith is a place of doubt. Where does the doubt come from? It comes from the place of me relying upon my own human ability. Oh no, what am I doing now? I shouldn't be out here on this water. Get back in the boat quickly. I need to retreat quickly to the place of my own, you know, security, my place of safety, where I can control it, or at least think I can control it. Where I have some kind of power to grab a hold of the rudder, to trim the sail, to bail the boat. At least give me a bucket, I can bail the thing out. But out here walking on the water, you know, who knows what's going to happen to me. Look with me also in a very similar verse of Scripture in Matthew chapter 8. Because Jesus is going to deal with something very similar here. And I'll just pick it up at verse 23 just so you can see the context a little bit better. Of course, this comes right on the instruction of Jesus saying, sorting out for people that say that they want to be able to follow Him. They say they want to follow Him, and He's going to address their issues. And of course, Jesus says there, Jesus says to the verse 20, well, let me get verse 19. A certain scribe came to Him and said, Master, I'll follow you wherever you go. Jesus is like, right. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
You guys must be worn out. Jesus said unto him, the foxes have holes, and the birds of the air have nests, and the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head. Now how do you feel about following me? Where, he said, in other words, where are we sleeping tonight? I'll follow you wherever you go. Well, guess what? You know what? We have less than foxes and birds. So I'm first and foremost, I'm going to deal with your creature comforts. I'm going to deal with all the things that you think that you need to have a good and wonderful life. And he says to another disciple, said to him, Lord, suffer me first to go bury my father. Jesus said to him, follow me, let the dead bury the dead. How insensitive. What are you going to do about it, standing around with the rest of the people, showing, paying your respects? What's that going to do? Well, it's just an honor thing that we do as human beings to honor, and if we don't do it, we're going to be, you know, in bad sorts with the mother-in-law and the father-in-law and whoever else. Jesus said, no, just let the dead bury the dead. We'll take care of all that later. Come follow me. People want to try to change us. Jesus is the worst humanist that ever lived. He has no human compassion, no human sympathy. He has no part or participation in the human program. He's an entirely different realm. He has something far greater. All the rest of the stuff is just, it's just smoke and mirrors. It's fake and pretend. It's not real. If it's challenged, it will disappear. It's not really there. It's not long lasting. It's not enduring. Love you today, hate you tomorrow. That's just the way it is. Friends today, enemies tomorrow. It's just the way it is. Very few people have friends that last longer than 5 years. They say the statistics of it is that very few people do. You're very special if you covenant people. I mean, divorce rate is so huge. We love each other so much, we're going to commit our lives to each other, and then, you know, in no time, all of a sudden, they're enemies. And it's just, it's the way of men. God's saying, listen, I'm not going to participate with that. I want to cast a terrible perspective on all the human realm so that you can understand really how bad it is. And so in this midst of Jesus really challenging people about what it really means to follow him, because when you follow him, you're going to leave fake love and get into real love. You're going to leave fake peace and get into real peace. You're going to leave fake compassion and get into real compassion. Huh? You're going to leave all of the falsehoods and get into the truth. People just believe, they've convinced themselves that what they know and the way they feel and the way they behave, it's really the truth. But it's not, unless it is something that God the Holy Ghost is producing, and he's going to show you how to behave yourself differently. Amen. And we're not going to walk by you and get just a little, you know, half-faced grin like he's paralyzed. There's going to be a bright, shining glory of his love. There's going to be an approachableness about you. There's going to be a love and a glory of God, something attractive about you. I tell you, Ryan, you take the ugliest person on the earth, fill them with the love of God, and they become the most beautiful person. Hallelujah. Take the most beautiful person in absence of the love of God, and they're pretty ugly. It's true, people. The Lord wants to beautify us with his glory. If I could just convince you tonight that everything that you do your way is absolutely despicable. The deplorables. It's true. That is all of humanity. Everybody's all upset about somebody calling somebody deplorable. Well, that's who y'all are. That's who we all are until we come. God came to save the deplorables and the despicables and the people who just didn't get it, who lived in hate and strife and envy and turmoil and destruction. And now not only did he come to save us and deliver us from it so that we're not victims of it anymore, but he's come to train us and teach us how to show forth the reality of that love that came and rescued us. And he wants to instruct you. He wants to show you how to flow in the Holy Ghost. Amen. He wants to show you how to walk in the Spirit.
Amen.
He wants you to show you how to love instead of hate. Amen. He wants to show you, even in the midst of it all. In the midst of it all. In the midst of all of the opposition. If I could just get people to just, you know, I figure you got 168 hours in a week. If I could teach people how to set everything aside 1 hour out of 168 hours, set everything aside so that God gets nothing, unrestrained worship and affection from you, where there's nothing there in between you and Him, not a problem, not an issue, not a sorrow, not a sadness, not a fear. People walk around and frowning. People mostly frown. It takes more muscles to frown physiologically because they're oppressed. They live in an oppressed world. I would invite you to listen to God and get out of that oppressed world.
Yeah.
Come on now.
Yeah.
And step over here into a place where you can walk around with a smile on your face instead of people wondering when they walk by you, wonder what's wrong with them. Wonder what's their problem. Wonder they must be in pain. And then, I mean, I remember last month they were this way. I figured they would be healed by now, but they're still that way. And then when it becomes years, then you know there needs to be heart change. And we, the representatives of God, we're going to, and the only way that we're going to be fit representatives of God is that we say, okay, I'm going to learn how to stop doing it my own way, and I'm going to learn how to move in the Holy Ghost. I'm going to learn how to be overwhelmed with His presence. You can stay in a place of worship in the Lord. It won't take long, dear people. You give yourself to knowing God and being led by the Holy Ghost. It won't take long and you'll be overwhelmed by His presence and then start moving and speaking and talking and living out of that overwhelming glory. Because unless you're overwhelmed by His presence, you're going to continue to do whatever you feel to do, whatever you think to do, whatever that reflects to the circumstance would be. Whatever reflex there would be to the circumstance, you will do that for the rest of your life until you are taken over by another power other than you. Father has made it to where that those of us who are joined to the Lord, and I'm looking around and that's everybody here tonight, that we're supposed to be one spirit with God, to where that God the Holy Ghost has mastery and rulership over our life. But what we don't understand is that He's a perfect gentleman. He's not going to force anything upon us. He's going to just always be there saying, let me take control. He's always going to deal with us in His word. Come on, let me take control. Quit being in control. The moment in time that we stop being in control, we start recognizing, wait a minute, I'm going to stop living after my own impulses, after my own thinking my own thoughts, driving my own conclusions and decisions in the realms of fear. It's true. People hurry up and decide when fear sets in. Oh, is it always terrible? Those are the imaginations that you need to be casting down. People get themselves in a fix and all of a sudden they go to thinking. You're never going to hear God there. You'll never hear God in the midst of fear. You will never hear Him. You will never hear Him. And I'm going to tell you right now, the majority of the decisions that you make are in fear. They're in fear, under threat, under peril of some situation. And you can never walk in the mind of Christ there. It's just, once again, it's the arm of flesh. It's human. It's the human existence. It's the self realm. The Lord wants to teach you how to get out of doubt. And how to get out of a realm of just living in little faith and cause faith to grow and mature and develop in your life, because you give yourself to that realm. God gave everybody a measure of faith, and at that measure of faith, out of that measure of faith, divine grace or the working of God is then expressed in your life. If you give yourself to that realm, then you will develop in it and you'll become strong in it, whether it's a gift of the Spirit or whether it's a fruit of the Spirit, whether it's having love made perfect. Your love's not made perfect if you have fear going on in your life. Right. Fear has torment. That's the whole realms of what people are living in and all of the various different things that they're suffering. And God wants you and I to come into a fellowship with Him, a place where you know and understand how much He loves you, and you're able to completely yield yourself over to Him and submit yourself over to Him, that you'd rather die than move out on your own initiative or do it your own way. I know how hard a case we are with God, because I've been pastoring for over 30 years. Almost 34 years. And we just hard-headed. You could tell people, don't do that, don't do that, don't do that, don't do that, do this, do this, do this, do this. And everybody are good. Most people are going to do what you told them not to do, and they're not going to do what you told them to do. And so this is God's peril. This is His situation. And we're all like, huh? Wherein have I sinned? I don't know where I did that. That's right, because only God can give you revelation. He's only going to give you revelation as you walk in obedience to Him, and that obedience is going to cost you your life, and you can't do it your way anymore, and you've got to shut that down. And I know that that is tragic. That's hard to do. It's tragic. You're just uncomfortable. It doesn't feel right. You just, there's no, come on. You're going to have to get captivated, caught away in the realms of the Holy Ghost for this to have a real flow to it where you can really feel it. And tonight we wish prateya. We want to help you feel this. I want to help you feel this place. I want to help you feel this place of no doubt. Of no doubt. Okay? No, a place of no doubt. I'm going to show you something. Show you something right here. So Jesus just lays this out. Because I want to help you with how to live in a place of no doubt. Understand doubt a little bit more. So he's now telling what it's like to follow him. And now here's the rest of them that follow him. And those that are following him now got themselves into some trouble. Once again. And when the disciples entered into the ship, behold, there arose a great tempest in the sea, and so much that the ship was covered with waves, but he was asleep. There's no fear there. There's total rest there. There's total peace. He's good. He's good. He's knocked out. Everybody else is fighting for their existence. They are fighting for their lives. Within the next minute, they're more than likely all going to be at the bottom of the sea. But that's not reality. That's the way they interpret their situation. And we're always interpreting our situation, interpreting our needs, we're interpreting our wants, we're interpreting every dimension of our life based upon our fears. And that's the place of doubt and unbelief. And so the Lord, they came and they woke Jesus up and said, don't you even care? The disciples came to him and woke him saying, Lord, save us, we perish. Of course, in Luke it says, don't you care? Care us not, or Mark, don't you care? We're all about to die here. What an insult. You're just sleeping, you snoring away, you're just taking care of your own self. We're all about to be at the bottom of the sea. And here's what Jesus says to them in both instances. He says, why are you so afraid? Oh, you have little faith. And he arose, and he rebuked the wind and the sea, and immediately there came a great calm, and they were all shocked out of their mind going, what? And he's saying, this is what it looks like to walk in the Spirit. He's saying, this is what it looks like to walk in the realms of heaven. This is what it looks like to walk in love. This is what it looks like to walk in those things that I've come to give you. I'm expecting now for you to get up and for you to do it. Why didn't you do it? Why didn't you say to the wind and to the wave? Why didn't you command the storm? Why didn't you command this situation? Because I vested you with my love and I vested you with my authority. Why didn't you do it? So turn with me to 1 John here. Just look at this quickly with me. Now I'm going to just believe in God and give you some revelation here, but you got to be hungry for it instead of insulted. If you're insulted, you're just going to go away. I mean, you won't go away bodily, but you'll go away spiritually. Just go away. Because you were insulted. Jesus said, eat my flesh, drink my blood, and you got all offended. Huh?
I can't believe it. See, Peter's sulking. I can't believe it. I tried. He said, oh, you have your little faith. Why did you doubt?
Jesus was helping him. Jesus was developing him. I mean, praise God, Peter's constantly getting slapped around. Get behind me, Satan, you save us. Not this thing which God speaks, but which man speaks. You think like a man. Because he's like, you know, only the human compassion.
You're not leaving us, Lord Jesus. I rebuke you. You're not going to go to the cross. You're going to be king.
He says, get behind me, Satan. Whole denominations have forgot that part. He was moving in the revelation of God. When he was moving the revelation of God, he was saying what God said. So all of a sudden he started moving in the way of fear, what fear dictated, and he started saying, no, you're not going to die. You're not going to go to the cross. They're not going to kill you. And so Jesus says, you're speaking just like a man. Get behind me, Satan. See, he doesn't make a lot of distinction between man and Satan. Come on now. How many people are willing to be trained by God the Holy Ghost like that? I tell you, there is not many. For most people, when God the Holy Spirit comes to try to help you understand how to function and flow in the anointing, you draw back. You don't want to listen. You want to do it your own way. You become offended. You become insulted. And you're just going to have to get over you. I want to make you so ugly that you don't want to have nothing to do with you no more. Yeah. I want to make your life so stinking pathetic that you know, it's like one man of God said, I stared looking at a dog thinking that dog has a better existence than I do. It was before he was saved. That was actually Charles Simeon trying to get right with God. And there's other people that have the same thing because they had a real encounter with God. They're thinking it through. Suddenly their brightness, their demonic brightness, wasn't so beautiful anymore. See, Satan was good till all of a sudden, because of his brightness, his heart was turned against God. He said, you know what? I got some ideas here too. Hello. I got some thinking here too. I got some creative thoughts here too. I got some things I want to accomplish too. You just all want us to do it your way. Sound familiar? I know you're the creator, but I think I'm brighter than you are. Huh? You know, I tell this on Joshua. I love to tell it, though. I hate to, but I love to, but just be perfect. When he was 5 years old, he was having trouble blowing his nose. He said, Dad, I can't. He was having a situation, you know, one of those situations. I can't. And I said, son, close your mouth and breathe out of your nose. And he did it. I said, now, when you get older, I'm going to remind you, I taught you how to blow your nose. But we soon forget those kinds of things. He never forgot. He's always had honor for me. He's always done what he'll live for a long time. God says, honor your father and your mother, so shall your days be long upon the earth. Honor your father and mother, which is the first commandment with promise. Praise God. Amen. Hallelujah. And kids, if you have parents who love the Lord and want to walk with God, you're not honoring them, shame on you. Huh? So somebody said, well, they just don't walk with God the way they should. Well, you know what? Just give yourself a break. In honor of them. Amen. Because the reality of it is, I found it over and again. I've spent a lot of time doing marriage counseling. I'll ask people, say, you know, to a woman, I said, so how do you feel about your father? And then sometimes some things that start coming out, well, I feel this and I feel that. And I said, that's the way you're going to treat your husband. Why don't we get this healed before you take this into the marriage? And he has to live with you for the rest of your life. You know, say the same thing to the woman. I mean, you know, to the man, say, how do you feel about your mom? How do you treat your mom? And then, you know, and don't give me no halo story either. You're talking to God, and I pray that the lightnings of heaven will strike you down if you lie to me. Okay? I'm calling the fire of God upon your life. I'm going to tell you right now, I'm going to retain your sin if you lie. Get people trembling so they'll tell you the truth. Now, Scripture says, whatever sin you retain, they should be retained. Whatever sins you remit, they should be remitted. But people don't believe that anymore, but God does. God does. Yes. People don't want to honor his bishopric. People don't want to honor his ministry, but God does.
Yes. Amen.
Huh? Amen. I'm not going to go into that tonight. I'm going to lead that. You need to read the Bible more. Amen. Of course, you can read the Bible all the way through every other day. But only God can show you what it really means and show you how to function in it. And he's only going to do that because you really want to, because there's an obedience in your life, because you're at that point of decision where you're going to either rely upon him or rely upon yourself. You say, no, I'm going to rely upon you. Yes. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
It's true. Yes. Dude, let God talk to you tonight. Let him change you. Yes. Don't draw back because of unbelief. Yes. Don't draw back because of fear. Don't draw back because of offenses. Don't draw back because you feel abused, that no one loves you. That's a bunch of nonsense. When you've got God's love, you don't need anybody else's love. But besides that, to try to level those kinds of things against the anointed of the Lord, please don't do that. Please don't do that to people. The Lord's calling us into an intimacy with him. He's calling us into a place where we learn how to function in an entirely different way. And fundamentally, that is just being so secure in love that you are just, you become a servant of everyone. You become the servant of all. You become so secure in his love. His love works out within us a lowliness and a meekness. His love works out within us a yieldedness and obedience, a childlike trust. That's what His love will do for you. Are you allowing His love to be effective in your life? Are you still holding on to your own self? In other words, if His love is being effective in your life, you are more of a servant today than you were yesterday. And you're learning to be the servant of all. And everything, the consequences, the real impacts, the real descriptions of love, not only as it's described in 1 Corinthians chapter 13, which, by the way, isn't only for weddings. It's the Lord telling us how we're supposed to live out our lives. Please, you know. There's so many issues. And God in His mercy and His long-suffering just loves us through them all. Don't get me wrong. He loves you through them all. He just can't use you very much. If you limit God to interacting only in a human realm, that's all you're ever going to have. But He wants to show you how to move in the realms of His Spirit, move in the realms of His ways, move in the realms of His glory. And that's learning it a whole new way, a whole new way of existence. And there are those factors that prove to you that you're allowing God to develop in your life what it is that He wants. You can know that you're giving yourself to the Holy Ghost because every day you hate evil more. Somebody came to me and they said, you know, I don't know whether it's me or I'm relying upon myself to do it or whether I'm relying upon God to do it. I said, let me ask you one simple question. Are you being successful or not? And they said, no, I'm failing. I said, then that's you, because God succeeds every time. If you rely upon Him, you're not going to fail. You're going to get it right. Yes. It's just that simple. Truly, truly, truly. You don't have to feel bad about yourself. You can feel good about Him and just simply say, Lord, I don't get it. And He's like going, wow, this is a moment of epiphany. This is a moment of great revelation. Many people have never come to that point. Lord, I don't get it. Lord, I can't do this without You. Lord, there's no possible way that I can live this life that You call me to unless You take full control of me. Yes. Amen. Yes. And He's like, really? Will you just hold that thought for longer than a minute? Could you hold that thought? Could that sink in deeply so you'll begin to rely upon Me, trust in Me? Look to Me. Man, you begin to look to God like this, you'll never doubt your salvation ever again. Yeah. Ever. Yeah. Ever. Yeah. You look to God this way, you'll never walk in fear ever again. Yeah. And every time there's fear, all you're getting to see is you get the responses. Lord, I don't get it. I want to get it. Come help me. Come strengthen me. Come give me the divine ability. And all He does is strengthen us and empower us so that we get it that much better. Because it's a relationship, and it's a relationship where we completely rely upon Him as sovereign God, walking with Him and doing the things that He's commanded us to do, to go cast out devils, to raise the dead, to all the wonderful works of His love that sets people free from their agony and sorrow and death and pain. It's a state of yieldedness. It's a state that works out because we just live and dwell in His love. And the quality, the factors that prove that is every day we're just more enjoying being servants. We just more enjoy walking in lowliness and meekness. We don't need to defend ourselves. I was in a situation one time, and these people were saying all these things, and there was a person there that has known me for a while, and they said to a person, well, if Pastor Mark's not going to defend himself, I'm going to get up and shut everybody down. Well, guess what? I really don't need that. In fact, all that they said, it didn't even get in my skin. I mean, it didn't even touch me. It didn't even touch me. It makes no difference whatsoever because I'm captivated in the realm of love. I've given myself over to a place that stuff doesn't even matter. All that matters to me is obeying God and doing what it is He says to do. I'm happy to walk in this place of lowliness and meekness before Him where there is no self-defense. And it's not something, it was a time in my life where it was something that I had to aggressively give place to. I had with a lot of effort say, oh God, help me. But it was a place I grew into and matured into to where the now it's just I'm just living in that. I just hallelujah. And every day I want to see humility in a greater way. I want to see meekness in a greater way in my life. I want to see lowliness in a greater way in my life. And what that's going to be, and that's going to, those things are going to testify to a greater obedience to Him, doing it His way. There is a mute button on all the people that need to use electronic Bibles. You got a volume switch. It's on the side. It's on your left-hand side. It's good. Can we show you how to lay hands on people and the sick get healed?
Yes.
Yeah.
Can we show you how to speak in the power of God, the lightnings of God strike folks' hearts?
Yes.
Can we show you how to worship and His presence filled and His glory fill the room? Can we show you how to pray and your prayers be heard and immediate response and answer come? That's what God the Holy Ghost is saying. That's what the Lord Jesus is saying. That's what the Father is doing. That's what His Word is all about. That's why He gives anointings that He's placed within His house. Apostles, evangelists, pastors, prophets, teachers. I mean, we're going to have the 16th of October, we're going to have an evangelist here. The end of October, we're going to have an apostle here. Then back in the second week of November, we're going to have another evangelist here. Here you got a pastor here. Someone to help you. Someone who loves the movings of God. Loves the things of the Spirit. Want to help you to begin to speak by the Spirit. Move by the Spirit. But I mean, you got to quit doing it in your own way. There has to be a response of confidence towards God. You can't even come near the Lord without a true heart and full assurance of the faith. Did you know that?
Yeah.
We've got to help you with those areas where you don't have a true heart and full assurance of the faith, where you've got doubt and unbelief, where you've got uncertainty in your life. If there's no confidence, faith isn't even going to work. And Father wants to bring in and develop in our life such a confidence that you're so confident that you're going to function and flow and operate in the gifts of the Spirit, you would be more confident in that than you are confident in your legs to take you up that stairs, or you're confident in your ability to remember something. Oh, give me a minute. I'll remember. Hold on just a second. I'll remember. I'll get it. I got a good memory. Hold on. I got a photographic memory. It's just films kind of. Whatever we do, the things we go through, that we're confident in what we can do. Suddenly we begin to be confident in what God will do through us. God doesn't really need your help. Does anybody know that?
Yes.
Look at all He created. Even nobody around needed any assistance. He didn't need anybody to have faith. Huh? Come on. Amen. Papa's got this. And now He wants to bring you into an eye into a partnership with Him to where we're one with Him, where we're serving Him like He's serving us. He said to us, He said, whatever you ask me, I'll do. That's pretty radical. We need to say back to Him, well, whatever you ask me, I'll do.
Yeah.
Hey? Now we're getting somewhere. Now we got some agreement here.
Yeah.
If you look at faith, faith is found in the Old Testament. When it's first seen, where it was counted unto Abraham for righteousness because he believed God, it's the Hebrew word amen. And amen is when we say amen. And how do you say amen? You say amen to those things that you agree with. It's really, faith is about agreeing with God. It's just that He asks us to do things that you're going, huh? Walk on the water? What? Raise the dead? Take no thought for what you shall wear. Take all of your finances and sow them into the kingdom. Is God saying we shouldn't have a savings account? Argue with yourself in the mirror. Because Papa's not going to talk about it. He's going to give you an opportunity to step into the realms of that that goes beyond human supply. Of that goes beyond human ability. But as long as you're retreating to your own flesh, your own self-interest, your own human ability, you can never walk in the Spirit. You can never have the things He has for you. You'll never develop in God. You've got to get to a place where you've got enough confidence in Him and courageousness in Him and boldness in Him that you can stand there and face your fears without having a complete breakdown and coming unglued. Taking person hunting for the first time, you know. They see it, you know, they see the deer. And, you know, they got him shooting pretty good, but now they got the deer, and you're like, they can't handle their fear. They can't handle their excitement. Right? It's the first time. And there's a lot of stories to go on with that. And we're dealing with that all the time till we get out of us and get into Him. Then we know, then we're sheltered from the storm. Right. Everybody's bold and brave until the bombs start going off. You know what I'm saying? Have you ever heard a bullet whistle by your ear? It's a weird sound. It hurts. It's such a wild sound. Hurts your ears. Everybody's brave until that happens. Well, Father, there's a place you and I can be in God that it doesn't matter. It's like one person said, we can be as confident in bed as we are on the battlefield. Pretty radical, eh?
Yeah.
To think about walking in that kind of trust, that kind of love. Ooh, hallelujah, that kind of fellowship. The people who are really trusting God and loving God aren't sitting there, you know, hanging on to themselves and you know, fighting so hard to continue on in their own condition and disposition. All that is fear. People who argue the most are just afraid that what they believe is wrong. Father just wants to move you out of fear into the realms of His love, and there in that place of love and fellowship with Him, there's going to be absolute confidence. There's going to be absolute trust. There's going to be no fear, therefore there's going to be no doubt. And you and I are going to find ourselves moving in every dimension of the works of the Lord Jesus Christ. We're going to find ourselves in that place of serving Him and obeying Him and doing it His way. And when somebody comes and instructs us and says, don't do that, I don't have to holler at people 4 or 5 times before they get it. And the Lord's touching somebody this morning. I said, don't touch her, don't touch her. And I said it like 4 times, and then finally I got a response. I figure I was thinking, testing, 1, 2, 3. Is the thing even on? We're so fixated on our own thing and doing it our own way. People don't need no help when they're knocked out on the floor. They only need your help if they can't touch heaven. Then get around them, everybody holler and pray. But when God's touching them, don't touch them. I don't touch people. I learned enough about walking the Holy Ghost. God's touching, don't touch them. Unless the Lord tells you specifically to do something. And then there's going to be a proof with it. There's going to be a sign, a wonder, a miracle. Yeah. No, we just want to do it our way. This is what I feel. I do what I feel to do. And I just feel it's God. Well, it ain't. And you're going to have to learn to let His Word lead the way. And let His Holy Spirit lead the way. And He's going to use leaders in your life to do that. And all the time you can be confident about His love for you, that you're never despised and unwanted and rejected. The first thing that God is going to deal with, though, is your intense need to be right. Your intense need to be able to do it and rely upon yourself. That's where the crisis is, people. That's where the struggle is. If you could just let go, if you could just surrender yourself to Him, just begin to truly understand that you and I are good to go. I mean, we're filled up with everything that Father has. His love, His unfailing love is in His commitment to us, immeasurable commitment to us. We can entrust ourselves fully to Him. Let Him develop us and grow us and mature us. We don't have to do it our own way anymore. We don't have to do anything. Just sit there and enjoy His presence. And then as we do, the explosive movings of God will begin to take place in our life. Explosion. And the explosions of God.
Yeah.
The explosions. Explosions. Dunamis is a word that is related to an English word, a Latin word, for dynamite. It's an explosion. The dunamis, which is translated the power of God. You should receive dunamis. After that, the Holy Ghost has come upon you. It's explosions of God. So I'm believing tonight that you're going to have some explosions.
Amen.
Because some of you are just desperate to get this. So God will give you the spirit of wisdom and revelation and knowledge of Him so that you can understand how not to doubt. You can understand how not to be afraid. You can, where there is no fear and there's this love, there's this boldness and this confidence, and you can stand up and you can speak to the wind and the wave, and it's got to obey you. It has to obey you. You can walk on the water and then not sink. You can move in the authority of heaven. You can step out and give all of your finances in the offering and end up with more. It's heavenly math. It's supernaturally math. Supernatural math. Somebody said, but if I give it all, I won't have anything else. That's you. Yeah. That's not what God said. God said, I'll multiply it to you. I'll give you more than you've ever had. I've watched so many people take what little they've had and begin to move in love, not out of obligation. Sometimes people are just, you know, they just do it out of obligation. Don't do it out of obligation. Just sit there and look like a pies and pup. Until all of a sudden, it's country term, until all of a sudden, all of a sudden, this fellowship with God causes this affection to explode on your on the inside, where you just have the want to, the love to, the desire to, that's the faith to, then the miracle works. Because miracles aren't going to work without faith. Miracles are not going to work in the realms of fear and doubt. If I do this, this is really risky. You're going to have yourself some fellowship before you're ever going to really take a risk. I mean, I take a risk, but it's not risky. You know what I'm saying? If I go to some crazy country like Kashmir that the Afghanis won't go to, the Afghanis from Kabul are afraid to go to Kashmir, and I go to Kashmir and feel at home, huh? That's risk, but I'm not risking. It's not risky for me. It's risky, but I'm confident. Father wants to take really, it's risky, but He wants to, as it were, take all the risk out. You're just confident. You're bold. Somebody says, you're going to die. It's like, I don't care. It doesn't matter. People say, what's wrong with you? You got a death wish? No. Whether I live or whether I die, I'm in His presence. And besides that, I'm not redundant, because right now the few are doing the work of the many. And so, you know, fathers are so human resource limited as it is. I'm sure He's going to take good care of me and protect me. I mean, if there was a lot of people doing the work of the ministry, who knows? I mean, maybe it'd be better for me to be with Him. Is there anybody in here tonight, honestly, you could honestly say you would rather be with Him than you are, than to be here? Because I want you to think about that, because you've got a lot of attachments. And when you really think about that, hey, you know what? I'm going to die. Somebody was told, you were told, you got 24 hours to live. I mean, all the emotions and all the feelings that go along with that. Well, what happens if you've stepped over in the love of God and you're already living in heaven? And you've already got a new value and a measure of time? And that life is but a handbreadth. And now you've applied your heart to wisdom, because you know you're going to stand before Him. And with Him, there is no end of life. There is no end of days. Huh? Father's more interested in, we think about our relationships and our loved ones. Father's more interested in maintaining relationships than we are. He's the one who designed relationships. He's got that covered. Father wants you to step over into a place where you're so emboldened, so confident in His love, that you won't concern yourself with what you're going to eat or what you're going to wear, that you'll take what you have and have treasure in heaven. It's all about ministering to the things of the kingdom of God. You're not worried about what somebody else is going to be doing with it. Somebody said, well, what if I give finances and it's to the wrong person? It doesn't matter. In your heart, you gave it to the Lord, and the way He's going to respond to you is though you gave it to the best ministry on earth. It doesn't matter. You gave it to Him. And when you begin to move in faith, all of a sudden, because finances carry such a huge impact upon our trust, it is such a representation of our existence. That's why it's so near and dear to our heart and why God himself demands so much in that area. But I know of no one who trusted Father all the way and he didn't heap upon them lavish wealth. Lavished wealth. That they then simply were just that much more, Abraham being a great example of that, of a steward of the things of the kingdom. People are uncomfortable when we talk about their money because really reality of it is there's nothing that shines a spotlight upon your own self-trust than that. And that's why people are uncomfortable. There is nothing more sensitive to humanity than that realm. And the Lord says, no, forget about it. Take no thought for it. Let me take care of you. Look how well don't I do good with the birds? Don't I do good with clothing the ground? That's what he says. People say, they're trying to get my money. Listen, that is the biggest joke. It is truly the biggest joke. Everywhere we go, we pay to preach. We've always paid to preach. It's like, you're making money. Why don't you try it for a couple years? You'll come out with an entirely different perspective of things. Have there been people that have abused things? And I'm sure, I don't know anything about it personally. So I don't even know. I'm not going to say anything about it. I'm talking about the right, not the wrong. I'm talking about what God wants to do. God wants to do miracles, signs, and wonders through your life. What do you want? What do you want? You want a heap of gold, or do you want to be able to say, in the name of Jesus, go free, and somebody completely delivered from their torment, from the CNS disease, from demon spirits, from some afflicting sickness or ailment? Say, in the name of Jesus, you foul spirit of darkness, you loose your hold, and immediately that person is born again. And their life is created anew in Christ Jesus. What do you want? What do you call true riches? I'd rather be in a condition like Peter and John says, silver and gold have we none, but such as we have, we're going to give to you. Hallelujah. In the name of Jesus Christ, rise up and walk. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. How much fear would you have if tonight you didn't have any more money in the bank? Truly. If all of a sudden the money wasn't good anymore. There's no time to start moving in faith. You want to learn now. Yeah. Two answer beginners. If you having a problem keeping up with the people who are walking, what's happening when you got to keep up with when the horses are running? It is, you're just going to faint and you're going to weary. Father wants to learn, teach you how to trust him. People, things are going to get bad. They're going to get bad. They're going to get bad so they can get good. In the United States of America and across the world, it's going to happen. It's not if, it's when. And I, this book that I've got being released at the first of the year, that Charisma is publishing for me, which we're just so blessed. I mean, it's the foremost Christian publication group in the world. And what God's going to do with it, we're just excited to see. But, you know, we show in the scripture where everything is going, and you can interpolate to where you're at right now. All these things have got to develop. The Lord shows us all these various different milestones of things that have got to take place and got to develop. And then that day is going to come. The end is going to come. And we know that Father is pressing it to the end, and the end is ultimately going to come. There's a finite, limited amount of time between now and that time that the end is going to come. Where are we at right now on that scale? And we know what it looks like then. It's pretty bleak. It's pretty ugly. And are you preparing for that day? Are you willing to give yourself over to the Lord Jesus Christ so that your life can truly count? Because nobody's going to remember that you were a lawyer, a mechanic, a teacher, a doctor. No one's going to remember. Who's going to remember that? The only way that anyone's going to ever even know you existed is because you allowed God to do something great through your life.
Amen.
That's it. Otherwise, your life amounted to nothing. Will your children, will your grandchildren even remember who you are? Will your great-grandchildren remember who you are? And those are the only people that potentially would remember. Will they be able to recall your name to memory? Think about it, people. Father's got a purpose for our lives that is so beautiful and so wonderful. Why should we hold on to ourselves to lose it all. Let me read this verse of scripture to you in 1 John chapter 5. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father, for the spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of you. Thank you, Lord, that the eyes of the understanding can be opened. Thank you that people can begin to see you as you are so that they can let you be God. Folks are always saying, well, I don't believe God will ask that of me. Oh, yes, he will. He will ask it. He asks for everything. He demands that we no longer live. Hallelujah. To begin to believe that God could take better care of you than you can take care of yourself. That is a huge crossing over right there. That is a huge transition right there. And sometimes I watch people, they get a little worried, a little concerned about this. Don't. Just let God fill you with his love. Start off with just know that he loves you. He loves you so much that he gave his only begotten son for you. Just enjoy the love. Enjoy his goodness. Get so filled up with it, with him, that there's nothing that he would ask you that you wouldn't respond to and say, Lord, absolutely, I'll do that. And you can do it in confidence, knowing what he's going to do for you. He's going to take excellent care of you. He's going to provide for you better than he provides for the birds, and better than he provides for the ground, and better than he provide for Solomon. You begin to seek first his kingdom and his righteousness and all the things that begin to happen. When all of a sudden nothing is important to you is flowing in the Holy Ghost, moving in the expressions of his divine power. Hallelujah. All of a sudden you begin to be certain about this. You're not worried or wondering what's going to happen. You're not all downcast with the fact that it seems like that every time you do anything for Christ Jesus or try to move in the Holy Ghost, it's one big gigantic flop. Suddenly you're certain that when you begin to minister, the Spirit of the Lord is going to begin to minister too. Hallelujah. Amen. Things are going to begin to change in people's lives. Yes. Hallelujah. I mean, the reality of it is the things that I'm talking about right now, they're very, very challenging for folks to be able to even wrap their hearts around it. And really, it just needs to bring you to the next simple step of obedience in God, to simply come into a place where you'll follow his divine instruction and quit doing it your own way so he can perfect everything that concerns you. He's your provider. He's your protector. And he's your perfecter. Just walk with them one step at a time. Don't draw back. Don't hesitate. You know, I'm not telling you that God's telling you to empty your bank account tonight. I'm just challenging you about it and watching some of you clam up. You think of the Holy Ghost revival that the rich man missed out on. He messed up big time. If he would have just let go of all of his trouble, which he called his riches, he could have stepped into such glory. If you just let go of the things that you're holding on to about your life. And one of the things that the Lord will challenge us to do, and at first we're not even aware of it, we're not even conscious of it, he'll challenge us not to move in what we think. That suddenly we think this is what we ought to do, and the Holy Ghost says, don't do that. That is a moment of great breakthrough. Normally that's exactly what you do, and God says, don't do it. And you've walked into relationship enough with him, you've stepped into enough of an interaction with him through obedience, that his word is that much more real to you and practical in your life that you can actually hear him say, don't do that. Quiet. Don't move. And then you obey and you don't do it. And even, especially when you feel like there's an urgency, if I don't get it done now, I'm going to miss the opportunity. If I don't get it done now, we're going to be in trouble. If we don't do it now, there's going to be a consequence. And the Lord says, don't do it. Don't do anything. Don't move. And you don't move. And then all of a sudden, he comes and he whispers. His divine direction. And it is entirely, it's 180 degree difference. I mean, it's so totally different than what you were planning on doing. And suddenly you discover what it means to move in the direction of the Holy Spirit. Suddenly you begin to know in a more intimate way the direction of God that you learn to move in, because you simply read something in the Word and you said, okay, Lord, I will obey your direction. I'll do what your Word says to do. Now, all that's doing is maturing you, is developing you, is making you stronger, more apt in the realms of the Spirit to hear Him speak directly to you, give you words of knowledge, give you words of wisdom, give you divine direction, give you divine insight to know how to move in God, how to move in His blessing. I went out to just walk the dog yesterday. I went out to walk the pup. We're teaching him. Teach him, get your ball. Teach him what beside me. He's going to take care of the cows, so we don't have to move him around. Just get him. I don't have to chase after cows anymore. And I got out to walk him. And as soon as I got out and I'm looking up the hill, I heard in my spirit, there's danger ahead. And I looked and I said, well, I knew what God said. It's just God. I'm not worried about it. Danger ahead. I just got a warning. I just look. There's danger up there. Well, I'm not concerned about danger, but I know, at least I got the insight, right? So we're walking along, and then sure enough, it's dark, and you just walk along. There is a rattlesnake sitting right there in the middle of the road. It's a smaller rattlesnake. It's the kind that coils up, and you think it's just a stick. But it's in there perfectly set up to strike. And we could just be that much more vigilant, because he's always talking. He's always telling us about everything that's going on. He tells us it's going to be a tough meeting tonight. Just stay with it. Just stay with it. Even if they all fall asleep, just stay with it, because I'm going to get it done. I'm going to get it done. If they all look at you like they want to, you know, stone you to death, don't worry about it. Don't worry about it. It's going to be just fine. It's going to be good. He tells us. He shows us how to move with him. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
He'll show us. So as you're getting ready to face a temptation right now, you're getting ready to be in a situation that you've got to understand how to keep yourself, guard yourself now. That's wonderful. It's wonderful to wake up in the morning and find yourself loving righteousness and feeling about the world and the things that you interface with the same way that you've read about how God feels that have been in the Bible, and it's not something that you're obligated to do and trying to do. You're going to do it because he said to do it, but really in your desires, you want to do something different. Suddenly you find your desires conform to his desires, and it's something he did because he saw in you the willingness to obey him and walk with him. So he fills you with the divine wisdom and insight to have the same emotion, passion, develop desires as he has. And he put it in our lives when we are born again. But we've got to allow it to be developed. And if we're not going to say no to sin and iniquity, if we're going to constantly give over place to it, we're never going to know what it means to walk in the miracle of his life. But when he sees us standing up and going, no, I don't want that. God, I want you. Let it be known to all spiritual powers, those in heaven and those in hell and those on earth and those under the earth, that I want God. I don't want your stinking iniquity, devil.
Amen.
Has anybody in here said that besides me? It's good to say that. Let it be known. I serve notice now to all who can hear. I want God and him alone. I don't want your iniquity. God, I want your heaven. I want your ways. I submit myself to your sovereign rulership. Come destroy everything's not on your side.
Amen.
I'm telling you right now, that's going to knock some stuff down. That's going to change some things when it comes out of your heart. It's real. Suddenly you want God to be sovereign king. You want God to be sovereign ruler. You want his way to be supreme in your life. Things change, people. Addictions have no power anymore. Persuasive deceptions of darkness have no more influence. Hallelujah. You get hid away in a place of lowliness and meekness where you no longer have confidence in yourself. You have a vote of no confidence in you. You completely rely upon him. Then you become the servant of all, and you're looking for somebody to tell you what to do next who's anointed. You're not fighting anymore. Oh, you listening to me?
Yes.
And then when you have that kind of disposition, yeah, people say, oh, it's giving men control and right over your life. You're afraid. Fear controls your heart. No, it's not. It's an act of response to God. He's going to take full control of your life. But if you can't love those who you see, you can't love him who you cannot see. If you cannot follow the instructions of those whom he anoints that is set before you, you won't follow the instruction of the unseen one. And that's just the way it is. You're going to have to get out of fear to walk with God. You're going to have to get out of fear that has torment, that's constantly running contrary to everything that God is saying, and constantly suspicious. It's not a fruit of the Spirit. Despite many people's opinion, suspicion is not a fruit of the Holy Ghost or an insight of God. It is a demonic lie that's come to ruin everything about your life. Strife and envy, they are not fruits of the Spirit either. Sedition, unwillingness to follow the leadership, is sedition. It's not a fruit of the Spirit. Believe it or not. I mean, I can show you a bunch of verses of Scripture if you need to be convinced. It is actually a realm of the demonic. And so God, the Holy Spirit, can never take us to the place of walking on the water, of moving in his glory, of walking in his authority, of speaking by the Spirit. He's desperate to, but we've got to cooperate. So let me just read a couple of verses of Scripture to you. Just wonderful, amazing, glorious verses of Scripture in 1 John chapter 4. And the Lord says here, he says, in verse 12, he says, no man has seen God at any time. No one's seen the face of God at any time. No one's seen God in his fullness of his glory at any time. Moses didn't see the face of God. He saw the back. No one's seen God at any time. Dwells in a light which no man can approach to, neither no man has seen. But he says this, if we love one another, God dwells in us and his love is perfected in us. And that's powerful. I mean, you think about it. He just took it to another level. Huh? I mean, what would you rather? To see God or to have him come inhabit your life? Think about it. What's superior? To see him and behold his face, or have him come and dwell on the inside of you? It's certainly a superior position to have Almighty God come and dwell on the inside of you, because you could see his face and it's the last face you ever see. And I'm telling you right now, the world will see his face, heaven earth will see his face, and flee away from him. That ain't a good thing. And so he's taken this relationship in this realm of this love to a whole nother dimension that goes beyond what Moses was asking to see in the mount. Oh God, let me see your face. Exodus chapter 34. You can't and live. And Moses didn't even listen to him. It's like, I want to see your face. Doesn't even matter. Living don't matter. I just want to see you. So the Lord lets him see as much as he could see. And of course, we understand the consequence of that. Glory lit his face up. And hereby we see and do testify that the Father sent the Son. Rather, verse 13, hereby know we that we dwell in him and he is in us, because he's given us of his Spirit. No, I want you to back up with me here just in, let me see, where do I want to take you here? Here it is. Here's where I want to go. Verse 17. How are you doing? Miss Anna, how are you doing? Lift your hands towards heaven. There you go. Lord, touch her right now. Make her feel so wonderful and so good, huh? That it's better than Legoland.
Yes.
Whatever, in Jesus' name.
Yes.
Candelopra. I mean, if you're just sitting in a meeting and it's hot and it's just on and on and on, I mean, you're just bored stiff. But if you hook up with the presence of the Lord, you get to go to heaven.
Right.
Just hang with me a little bit more. We'll get the fun going here in a minute. Start laying hands on everybody. Verse 17. Here in his love,
Herein is our love made perfect. No, verse 16, I'm sorry. And we know, we have known and believed the love that God has for us. Listen, if God's going to dwell in you, I mean, he loves you. You reckon? Okay. Amen. And we have known and believed the love that God has for us. God is love. He that dwells in love dwells in God. Can you just get that?
Yes.
Well, if you get this, then there's no doubt or unbelief working in your life. And everything that God says is established in your life. And there's no sickness and there's no disease. And there's a complete and total ability to function in all that he's made available to us. Now, there's some part of this that you get. My challenge to you, God's challenge to us, is will we grow and mature in the reality of his love for us? And because people, what is coming out against that? Shame, condemnation, guilt, offenses, unrealized expectations, all the things that we think we want and we're not getting, things that we're confused about, circumstances and situations that aren't working out. Father's inviting us to come over here. I love you. Come over here. Live and dwell in my love. Understand, I'm for you. I'm with you. Rely upon me. Put your trust in me. And we can either, and that we're constantly taking one of two directions. It's always going on. I've watched people come into churches. I know other, into this church. I know of other ministers in the same perspective where God had great calls. I know people who have been come to this church 30 years ago. God had great calls upon their life. And because of offense, they went to another church. They went and did whatever it is they're going to do, wanted to do because of whatever they were thinking they needed to do out of their own realm of thinking, not out of obedience to submit themselves, not out of obedience to love, even when they felt persecuted, even though they weren't being persecuted, they were being called. And they never did anything. They've never done anything. Your life has been a loss. They never stepped in to the call of God, the anointing of God upon their life. They're just as stuck as they've ever were. They could have been set free. They could have moved in God's divine power and glory. Father's always inviting us to have our response of saying, I'll obey you. I'll walk with you. I submit myself to you. I'm just going to praise you. Somebody said, how do I get into that love when I feel all these other things? How am I going to just know how much he loves me? Just begin to praise him. Amen. Begin to give thanks to him. He'll fill you. The Holy Ghost will fill you with the love. He will supernaturally convince you. He will, I tell you, he will flood your soul. I promise you, he will flood your soul. I promise you, he will flood. He will flood your soul with mundane. Because if you try to think love, baby steps to love. I'm trying to love God. Baby steps. Oh, I know he loves me. I know he loves me. I'm sure he loves me. I'm convinced he loves me. Ain't nothing going to happen. You're just going to work yourself into a frenzy. Who knows? You might work yourself into a Medicaid state that way. I mean, come on. It's like he's letting God come and work a miracle on the inside of you because you're willing to do what it is, the response that you have that you can move in, that's right there available to you. It's not, I mean, you've got control over this. I mean, raise your right hand. Look, you got control. Look at you. Wiggle your fingers. Look at that. I mean, you've got control. I mean, it's just like, praise him. You just stop and praise him. Just say, thank you, Father, I'm going to believe you. I'm scared to death, but I'm going to believe you. I feel like the whole world's going to cave in on me, but I'm going to trust you. I wake up in the morning. I say, Holy Spirit, I do not know how to walk with you. I rely on you to show me how. I do not know how to be sensitive and yielded to you. Oh, God, teach me. God, I want to learn. I want to know. I want to do it exactly your way. And I have no ability within myself to understand that. Show me, give me insight, give me revelation. Come, move me by your power. I'm confident that when I pray that, he's going to do it. I'm not just speaking into the ear. I'm talking to God. Let that be developed in your life. Somebody said, I'm trying to remember what to do. Do it every day and you won't have to try to remember. In Jesus' name. Yeah, just go ahead and turn them all off. It'll be okay. Trying to slip out quietly, they turn all the lights on. That's the human effort, you know, that's what we do. We try so hard, it goes to work. Jesus. Look at this. Look at here. Herein is our love made perfect. You just give yourself to this.
It'll grow. It'll develop. He's given you a measure of faith. It'll grow. It'll develop. You just be diligent with it. You be committed to it. I'm walking with you, God. I want to step into a realm with you, Father, that is deeper, that is bigger than anything else anyone else has ever done. And therefore, the consecration and the commitment is going to be bigger than anything else anybody else has ever done. I'm going all the way with you, God. I'm not going to limit you in any way. I count my life not dear unto myself. I have nothing else going on that I want to do. I want to do you.
Amen.
That's it.
Amen.
I want to do Jesus. Amen. I want to do signs and wonders and miracles. I want to live out this life of your glory, of your holiness, of your righteousness, of your purity. Father sees it.
Amen.
Because then when you start throwing a fit, he's going to say, well, what are you doing now? Then when you're unwilling to worship, he's going, yeah, I see what you're doing. And when you're unwilling to follow an instruction, he goes, uh-huh. Mm-hmm. What are you going to do? Continue on the same situation, the same disposition? Because all you're going to do is get more of the same. No, you just change.
Yes.
Herein is our love made perfect. Fully matured, fully developed, so that we may have boldness in the day of judgment. And how is our love made perfect? Because we know and believe the love that God has for us, and that's constantly being challenged, but we know and we believe the love that God has for us, and we take a hold of it, and we praise Him, and we worship Him, and when the lies come, and when the slanders come, and when the accusation comes, and when every offense comes, we're just standing there going, Father, I thank you that you love me so much. I thank you that you poured your love on the inside of me. I thank you that you died for me at Calvary. I thank you that you've proven it over and over again. You take a stand, and and that's a place where you and I have to cast down fear.
Yes.
And in the midst of that fear, that's where all the doubts and all the unbelief and all of the uncertainty and all the imaginations and all the thoughts contrary to the knowledge of God assail us.
Yes.
That's where the reality of this comes to bear in our life, in our decisions. I know and believe the love that God has for me. God is love, and I'm going to dwell in His love. How am I going to dwell in His love? I'm going to believe what God said concerning His Son for me.
Yes.
I'm going to believe that there is no separation between me and Him. Hallelujah. That I'm one with Him, that He's in me and that I'm in Him, that He dwells in me. No man has ever seen His face, but He lives on the inside
Amen.
Of me and I live in Him.
Amen.
And the Lord says it over and over and over and over again, right here in just this one epistle. He says it over again, that we're one with Him. And He says, will you believe my testimony? If you don't believe my testimony that I've given of my only begotten Son, then you've made me a liar. He said, I'm a witness to it. God the Father says, I'm a witness to it. Jesus, the Word, the only begotten Son, is a witness to it. The Holy Spirit is a witness to it. He has the witness of the Spirit of truth in the earth and the blood and of the water that testified of redemption, of God having been made flesh and pouring out His life for us. And now all we have to do is just find ourselves unwilling to budge or move or turn our thoughts or our heart in any other direction. Herein is our love made perfect, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment, because as He is, so are we in this world. Is that something, listen people, that's something you get to be. It's not something you have to do. It's something that you get to be.
Amen.
Jesus. Amazing. Verse 18. There is no fear in love. Say no fear.
No fear.
Hold your finger there. Look in Romans chapter 8. I'm just telling you who you are, so don't let an old liar come and tell you something different. I'm telling you who you are. There are principles and things that you must obey in order to have these things consistent in your life, but this is who you are. If you walk in the Holy Spirit, if you walk in God, it's no problem for you to live this out. Verse 15 of Romans chapter 8 says, you've not received the spirit of bondage again to fear. Why? Because you've been liberated and been given the Spirit of the Son, whereby you cry, Abba, Father. Those are two opposite things. So all you got to be doing is when fear comes, saying, Start saying, Father, I thank you that you made me a son. I thank you that you made me a daughter. I thank you that you're in me and I'm in you. I'm going to stand here and praise you. I thank you that I'm going to let the word of God be a ladder by which I climb up into the realms of his glory and peer into his book of life and behold my own name there.
Amen.
I mean, come on, you know what I'm saying? It's, hallelujah. Hallelujah. You think about it. What God, the assurance, the great confidence and the boldness that God wants us to have in him, but we've got to give ourselves to the instruction of his word and of his spirit. And if we're allowing ourselves to be listening to a bunch of other things and contemplating a bunch of other ideas, all it's going to do is compromise us, conflict us, and keep us from ever fully giving ourselves over to what God has said. There's other options. God wants us to eliminate all other options, all other roads. Go one way, a narrow way. Walk with him.
Jesus.
There's no fear in love. Therefore, there's no doubt in love. To see yourself one with him, captivated by him, living out the same purpose, living out the same cause. To get you to wake up in the morning to be on a divine mission sent by God on a divine mission to display his power in his glory, the full measure of it. The full measure of it. Not wait. Step into the full measure of it. Being confident in him. Then what's going to happen is that's going to grow. And that's going to mature. And that's going to develop into the full expression of his life. And, that, and we're going to begin to understand. Anyone who believes, these works shall you do and greater works. And once again, it's easy to say I believe. But then all of a sudden, when you're challenged with circumstances and situations where you cannot, once again, lean upon the arm of your own human ability, but you shut that down and say, no, I rely upon you, Lord. That's where it's made strong. That's where faith is made strong in our life and fully developed in our lives. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Let the Lord touch you right now. If there's anybody here tonight and you're not confident about God's love for you, if there's somehow you feel like you're still trying to earn a good reputation with the Lord, I want to set you free and bring to you the liberty that is in Christ Jesus and recognize how you can take everything that is an offense and everything that is a wrongdoing in your life and you can let it go and be washed in the blood of Jesus. You can, as it were, have an opportunity to transfer every wrongdoing over to God and he'll take and completely remove it from off of your life. And now you're free to live in him. You're free to exist in him. And then you can just stay happy all day long in that. And if for some reason that seems to be compromised or somehow messed up, you can just run to him and say, Lord, I thank you for washing me in your blood. I thank you that my name is written in the book of life. I thank you that you're in me and that I'm in you. Father, that there's everything about my life you delight in. And you're going to perfect everything that concerns me. You're the one who's going to give me the ability to hate evil and love righteousness. You're the one who's going to give me the ability to walk in faith and not in doubt, to live in your love instead of being a prisoner of fear.
Yes, Lord.
You're the one who's going to help me to quit being so stinking hard-headed. And be willing to be led. To be a follower, to be an imitator of God and to imitate those who follow God. Jesus. Thank you, Lord 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 Jesus. Thank you for touching everybody sitting in this place right now. Thank you, mighty God. Thank you, Father. Lord, let your floodlight shine upon our soul and see. And behold everything about our life. And let us see it too. Father, we ask you to strengthen us that we would be totally yielded to you and submitted to you. Strengthen us right now.
Yes, Lord.
Father, those who just in this place, it's pretty much every single person that have labored this weekend has labored so hard. Father, I ask you to refresh them right now and strengthen them right now and encourage them right now. And Father, embolden them in the faith right now. Father, I pray right now in Jesus' name that there will be less human ability and more divine ability. There will be less of us and more of thee. Oh God, that you'll find in our life empty vessels, oh God, that you can fill up with all that you yourself possess. Empty vessels filled up to the full with you. Mighty God. Mighty God. Hallelujah. Lord, I want to come to a place in my life. We want to come to a place in our lives that you look at us and you don't say, oh, you have little faith. Why did you doubt? That you look at us and say, thank you for walking in faith. There is no doubt there. There is no unbelief. Father, just cause us to step over in understanding that realm of moving in that place of relationship with you where there is no fear, so that there is no doubt, where there is just absolute confidence and boldness in you, that you find in us obedient children, that you strengthen us to in every way be obedient, to do it your way, to have your responses to the world around us that we're going to confront tomorrow morning. That we're going to confront through the day, through the week. Father, that we'll have your fortification, your divine ability to look at the lust of the flesh and the lust of the eye and the pride of life and have nothing to do with it, rather to be captivated and caught away in divine glory. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. Si satarapo. Ambrandandele piara. Si taropo ifra sitaya. Papra sataramoshi. Father, that nothing about our lives can remain the same, that they will not go on in a merely human existence. But Father, in obedience to your word, we'll be conformed to the image of your Son. Father, that in obedience to your word, oh God, we'll completely yield ourselves over to the leadership and direction of the Holy Spirit.
Yes.
Father, that every person would come to a place that they understand in a very practical and a real way how to put on the Lord Jesus Christ, how to be overwhelmed with your presence, how to be anointed by you, God, with fresh oil every day. That every person in here will understand how to walk in this wonderful realm of your joy and your gladness, Lord, that brings such divine power and strength.
Yes, Lord.
Saturima, Saturima kisiprast. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. In the mighty name of Jesus. Faith right now in Jesus' name. Faith comes into your life. In the name of Jesus, everything that holds you back, let it go right now. Everything that you hold on to in this life, that you're holding back from God, release it right now in Jesus' name. Every area of your life, where you've not been willing to obey and yield yourself, where you've drawn back, recant right now. Say no more in Jesus' name. Let Father bring the change now. Let Father multiply you. Let Father take your life and make it so fruitful. Let floods of heaven come and fill your soul. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Everybody stand with me. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. In the name of the Lord Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Just lift your hands towards heaven. Let the power of God touch you. Let Him refresh you right now. In Jesus' mighty name. Everything about your life begins to change right now. Everything about your life begins to come under the authority of the Word of God and the Spirit of God, so that you can boldly say and you can confidently say that you're in Him and He's in you. You can have the confidence that what God has declared and said that you are to do in Him is there, and you can do it. You can function in it. You can be it. You're empowered to be it. You're empowered to live this glorious life. You're empowered to live this divine life. You're empowered to live this divine existence right now. Hallelujah. Holy Spirit, we thank You that You come and fill us with Your love. I thank You, Lord, that You come, You fill every person standing here right now with Your love. You pour Your love into their hearts right now. Right now, just go ahead and receive. God has given. Now just go ahead and receive. God has supplied. Go ahead and receive. God has supplied. Go ahead and receive. Do not remain earthly. Do not remain unaffected by God when He wants to rapture you away. If there's something that's hindering you and standing between you and that outpouring of heaven, then you just begin to cry out to God, and I guarantee you it's going to get out of your way. Now in the name of Jesus. Jesus. Hallelujah. Jesus. Father wants to supply something that causes you to overcome the world, where you're not overcome by the world, but you overcome the world. Come on now. Father wants to supply something to you that results in you living out the life of Jesus. And it's called the rain of heaven. It's called the refreshing of the Holy Ghost. It's called the pouring forth of the rivers of God. It's called the well springs of life. It's called the greater one who lives on the inside of you. It's called Christ in you, your confidence of glory. Just go ahead now. I want you to press in. Now I want you to go ahead and pray in the Holy Ghost. I want you to press in. Once you go ahead and lay hold on the joy of the Lord. Go ahead and lay hold.
Glory flowing from you now. have your way. Lord, have your own way with me. Lord, have your way. Lord, be revealed. Lord, be revealed in me. Reveal yourself in me. Lord, be revealed in me. Reveal yourself in me. Lord, have your own.
Feel his joy now. Feel the refreshing of the Lord. Feel his presence now. Let him feel you now. If there's anybody in tonight you did not feel the presence of the Lord, and just stand there. You need to say nothing, do nothing. Just let him feel you. Those of you who are being overwhelmed with the presence of the Lord, just continue on as you are. The Lord told us that he's written these things to us that our joy may be filled, full. He's given. He's come to dwell in us, that our joy may be full. He's come to overwhelm us with his glory. Be overwhelmed right now. Just don't. I don't want you to miss out on being overwhelmed with God. We don't want you walking out of here with you. With your problems and with your issues and with all your stuff. Want you to be, God says he wants you to be filled up with him. We want you to be filled up with his glory. We want you to be filled up with divine provision. Faith reaches out and receives what God has given. He's given the authority to anybody who will receive. He's given his glory to anyone who receives. Receive him now. Receive him now. Receive him now. Receive him now at the floodgates of heaven. Fill your soul. Receive right now. Just reach out and take hold of what God has liberally given. Receive now. I love to hear the sound of heaven in the house. I love to hear the sound of heaven in the house. I don't hear anything human in that. I don't. I just feel here. I hear it's heaven. God wants heaven to flow through your soul. You don't have to have your strains. You don't have to have those things that are just lifeless and dead. You can have a flow from heaven. God wants it's up to you to receive right now. And I'm telling you, the love of God is here to fill you with the ability to receive. The love of God is here to fill you with the ability to receive. I
I tell you right now, the power of God will flood your soul. I promise you, you will not look anything earthly. You will not look like you look right now. You will not look purely human. You won't look like just another religious person. You won't look like another Baptist or Pentecostal. You'll look like somebody's been touched by God and filled with His Holy Spirit. Filled with glory, filled with heaven. Father's here right now to touch you. Let Him touch you. There's a realm of walking in the Spirit that goes way beyond walking in the water. There's a realm right now. There's a realm for you right now that goes way beyond walking on the water. It's walking in the Spirit. It's being caught away in the realms of faith, translated, taken up, captivated. Break free of the human restraint. Break free of every fear and death. Break free of the sickness and disease. Break free of torment and condemnation. Right now, by receiving what God has to supply. God has these things for you now. Hallelujah! I'll bless the Lord, oh my soul, and all that is within me. Bless His holy day. If you will give yourself to being filled with the Holy Ghost, caught away beyond all the human things that we know within the respect of human feelings, and raptured in divine emotions, you'll give yourself to being filled with the Spirit. You'll begin to function in that which God supplied when He poured out this wonderful gift, the promise of the Father. If you choose, and please don't do it, to go on continually in your human experience with such a little display of the power of God, and that's what you abdicate to, that's what you allow, because I'm telling you, the demonic realm will hold you into a prison where you'll never begin to move into the realms of the fullness of being filled with the Holy Ghost. You'll never move into the realms of your emotions and your passions expressing the rivers of His glory that He commands. That's something that you give yourself to, and it develops and it grows and it gets bigger and it gets stronger because you're not willing to live without it. You're not willing to live without these holy emotions. You're not willing to live without this glory. You're not willing to live without this divine power of God taking hold of you and being expressed through you. So many people, there are even people here tonight, you've been willing to be in prison to a human condition. You've been willing to just be in prison to restraint upon your life. God is here with divine provision to fill you with a hunger and a passion to no longer live anything less than being full of the Holy Ghost, full of faith, full of power. I mean, you think about what God has done when He said, if you can believe, all things are possible for those who will believe. All you have to do is begin to believe. Right now, you put your trust in earthly things that perish with the using. And God's looking to bring you into a place where you can have all things. You can have all things, whatever you ask. There is I'm talking about an infinite supply. We on this earth, even though it looks big and it's huge, it's still finite resources. But within the framework of God, it's infinite resources. You can have a fraction of that. And you've got infinite resources. But He's giving you all of that. I mean, just think about that. You can't. It's too big. Go ahead. Go ahead. Go ahead. No. See, what's going on right now with some of you is now I'm gone from ministering to you and from the Word of God about faith, and now you're in a practical way confronted with breaking past the things that would hold you back and restrain you and conflict you and make you be a different thing than God has commanded. And don't allow it.
Don't allow it.
Let's go ahead and get filled. No, you don't have to try so hard. You just get happy. You say, yeah. You stand there, yeah. It ain't that hard. It isn't that hard, people. It's really not, it's really, in many ways, it's not even what's coming out of your mouth. It's what it looks like on your face. The Lord wants to write the pages of His love in your life. He wants to write the pages of His life. He wants to write the pages of His will. He wants them to be written upon your heart, upon your countenance. You know, I'm right now a prisoner of Jesus Christ. Last night I was just ministering to my wife when we went to bed. You know, we're laying in bed. And she was laughing so hard that her jaw, her face got stuck. She got cramps and she was stuck in a smile position. And she's already smiling all the time. So you know that was some pretty serious, ongoing Holy Ghost laughter. I'm having a good time just talking before we, as we're laying in the bed going to get ready to go to sleep. God is so good. People, God wants you to live an abundant life. Not some all messed up, you know, all wrapped up in the same cares and issues that everybody else is messed up with. He wants to put a skip to your walk. A glory on your face. A confidence and a boldness in your life. So that you can do what no one else on the planet will do. Hey, I'm getting ready to meet with Fidel Castro. I'm getting ready to meet with Raul Castro. You know, we all get to do whatever God put in our hearts to do, and I believe in God to do more. I mean, Tim was talking to me, he said, man, we just got back from Japan and from this place and that place. We've seen over 60,000 people coming to the kingdom. I said, I'm getting ready to meet with Fidel. He goes, you got to be kidding me. Who's ever done something like that? That's only God. And I say to you, Father wants to put you in your heart and in your life something that everybody will look at and say, who does anything like that? Walking on the water is nothing. Walking in the Spirit is something. Listen to me. Listen. Walking on the water is nothing. Walking in the Spirit, that's something. It's a realm of faith you cannot doubt. You'll sink. You'll just get all captivated with your stuff and what's going on and your issues and your disappointments. And you'll sing, good thing Jesus is there to pick us up, eh? And he immediately reached down and he caught him. Hey, it's good, yeah? And they're back in the boat. But look, come on, man. How about Enoch? How about Elijah? They set another bar. How about the way they moved with God? How about what Jesus revealed and said, I want you to do, I'm showing you a pattern of what I want you to grab a hold of, and I purpose you to do something even bigger. I gotta have that, and I wanna transfer that. I gotta have that to you. I want you to get out of whatever you're stuck in. Listen to me. I want you to understand. It's the enemy, it's oppression, it's cares of this life, it's open doors to say things that Satan would do to oppose you, that keeps you from this divine flow. And you've been given the ability by the power of the Holy Ghost to run through every troop, leap over every wall, stop everything that Satan is doing in his track, move up higher into the realms of faith. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
said, thank you, Lord, for the Holy Ghost that's filling up every part of my parts right now. Every part of my parts right now. Thank you, Lord, for the Holy Ghost that's filling up every part of my parts right now. Thank you, Lord, for the Holy Ghost that's filling up every part of my parts right now. Oh, thank you, Lord, for the Holy Ghost that's filling up every part of my parts right now. My parts right now, yeah. Hey, worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness.
I say that it happens to me, and I'm going to be helpers of your faith, that when you say that it happens to you and you're not just looking like you've been looking, God, the Holy Ghost is here to change the condition that your condition is in. Hallelujah. If you're filled up with Him, He wants to fill you more. The only thing that can hold you back is fear, condemnation, shame, guilt. Father wants to bring you into a culture of love, freedom, acceptance in the Beloved, access by faith. A faith that without it, it's impossible to please Him. A realm of yieldedness to the Holy Spirit that without it, it's impossible to please Him. And because He's so devoted to you and I being pleasing unto Him, He's empowered us right now, and all you and I have to do is learn how to move with the Holy Spirit. God wants to illuminate your mind. He wants to bring revelation divine so that you can see on the pages of His Word how to move with the Spirit. Here in this place, every action and every device and every weapon of Satan loses its power and effect. Here in this place, condemnation and shame and accusation and slander can no longer work against you. Here's where a life flow of heaven is supplied, that every sickness and every disease has to go away, and everything not of God no longer exists. There's a river flowing right now that'll turn your desert and your wilderness, any part of it, of your life that may be barren, into like a fruitful garden of Eden. And on both sides of that river that's flowing, there should be trees growing with 12 manner of fruits, continually bearing something new. and the leaves you get healthy on. It's for the healing of the nations. And you know, there's one like that in the millennial reign. There is. You read about Ezekiel chapter 47. That's not the same as Revelation chapter 22. Because what's going on, it's going to happen. There's going to be a, because in the eternal kingdom, after the 1,000-year reign of Christ, there will be no temple. Because God will be the temple of it. It'll just be the city four square. During the millennial reign, there will be a temple, and out of that temple, that house, will flow a stream. A spring will spring up right underneath the temple. And it'll flow out of the southern gate. And it will water the land, and where it flows out, immediately will begin to grow trees of life on both sides, bearing 12 manner of fruit continually. It's unimaginable. The leaves are for the healing of the nations. Everywhere the water flows, it will heal the land, because the land is going to be so messed up and destroyed. It'll be an exceedingly high mountain. Somebody says, well, it's not a high mountain now. Geography is going to considerably change during the tribulation. The mountains and the islands will be no more, because of all the devastation, the geographical changes that will take place. But in Jerusalem, there's going to be a high mountain. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. And then when the Lord's done with that, after he does the final purge of sin and iniquity at the end of the 1,000 years, as according to Peter, everything is going to be burnt up and melted with a fervent heat. And according to Isaiah, and according to the book of Revelation, the Lord is going to make a new heaven and a new earth. Hallelujah. He's going to take and he's going to change it all. And he's going to be purged of every iniquity and every sin and every rebellion that has existed since the day that Satan reared that head of rebellion against God. And there will be no more place for it forever. It will be eternally purged from all creation. And God is going to come and he's going to bring the new Jerusalem down out of the heaven, which is an exceedingly high mountain that goes up about 2,400 miles or so into the atmosphere, and it's about 2,400 miles wide. And there'll be no need for the sun to shine there or light there, because God will be the light of it and the Lamb. And that day, all enemies, all death, it'll all be destroyed, and Jesus will yield up the kingdom unto the Father, and the Father will be all in all. And the Lord shall be one, and Yehovah shall be one, and his name shall be one. According to Zechariah chapter 14, verse 9. Everything will be changed and everything will be submitted to him. And though Christ Jesus will be King of kings and Lord of lords forever, God the Father will take his place supreme in the sovereignty. He will reign. And all the beauty of it, we can get little glimpses of from Enoch. Because some of the things have been a bit distorted in the book of Enoch, because it wasn't, I don't want to go into all of it, but it wasn't held with quite the same kind of rigor and sanctity as the other books were. But I know of men who've stepped over into that realm. And they say, it's like this glorious realm that's superimposed upon this realm right now. It's just far more spectacular. And when you step over, it's right here. It's already right here. It's just that we can't see it. We can't interact with it. But on that day, we'll begin to understand what's been all around us all this time. And we understand that truly the earth is filled with his glory, even though we can't see it. Suddenly our eyes are open and we begin to see what's really going on around us, that the heavens are filled with the angels of the Lord and the horsemen thereof, that there are more with us than are with them. And God wants to give to you and I the spirit of wisdom and revelation. He wants to cause us by the Holy Spirit to be able to see Jesus walking around in his glory and his splendor, as Peter saw that night, that caused a spark of divine faith to begin to rise up in him on a whole different dimension, in a whole different level than existed up until that moment that he had that divine and supernatural encounter of Jesus walking on the water. See, when he saw the Lord there in the realms of the Spirit, suddenly faith filled him and the Word became real to him. And he walked out there too. God wants to give to us the same spirit of wisdom and revelation and knowledge of him tonight. Tonight, I'm not going after miracles tonight, so to speak, or gifts of healing tonight.
I'm going after something for you. I'm interceding for you. Because I don't know how you've been doing towards me, but what I've been doing towards you is I've been crying out to God for you. On your behalf. I found out the more you pray for people, the more you love them. I found out the more you give yourself to interceding for on their behalf, that the glory and the power and the riches of Christ Jesus may be known through them, more compassion will flow through you to them. Tonight I'm hooked up in the realm of faith that you step over in the spirit of wisdom and revelation, that your eyes will be open, that you begin to understand and cooperate with God so that he can show you how to move in the realms of the spirit. Because he's commanded, therefore he gives us the ability to do it. We're not left on our own, but if you repose to the arm of flesh and your own human ability to figure it out, and you once again go to straining and grunting and groaning and complaining and murmuring and feeling so big and bad about yourself, you're getting nothing. When you begin to get hungry and desperate, because God the Holy Ghost has come to fill us with hungry and desperate, and you begin to say to God, to our Father, oh, Papa, I love you so much, and I thank you that you've done this, and I want to get this. I want you to show me. I know I can't do it without you. Men have been so fascinated with themselves that they think that they can figure out what God has to say in his word on their own, on the means and the merit of their own intelligence. They've never really come to a place where they read the word and say, Lord, I can't understand a single thing you say unless you show me. Or we can understand the surface thing, that we can understand the most important thing, call upon the name of the Lord Jesus and you'll be saved. You can understand basics like that, but to begin to move in the realms of heaven, to begin to move in the realms of his love and of his power and of his fullness and of his glory that has been made available to us so that we can do these works and greater works. Oh, no. Obedience takes you into a realm of revelation. Obedience takes you into a realm of complete submission to the Spirit of the Lord. See, I'm pressing in for you tonight. I'm not looking at where you're at. I'm looking at where God's called you to be. I'm not going to deal with the complexity of your issues or the complexity of your situation or the complexity of the things that hold you back, that conflict you. Neither should you. You need to look at what God's called you to be and then rely upon the Holy Ghost to do it, to make it, to show it. And then with faith, know it, because there's no fear. You're not in doubt. You're not wondering if it's going to happen. You're not asking all the questions why and needing to debate with God and have him explain to you what he did when he did it long ago and why he commanded it the way he said it. But you just say, yes, Lord, build me now. Yes, Lord, I want to see. Yes, Lord, I want to know. Yes, Lord, I want to walk with you. Yes, Lord, I want to move with you. Lord, I want to know what it's like to be translated. I want to know what it's like to see you in your glory, walk with you in the Spirit. I want to understand what it's like to have rivers constantly pouring, gushing out of my innermost being. I love that song that you're singing this morning. I've tasted that new song, Crystal. I've tasted enough, and I want more. Beautiful. Yes. That's it. That's what I want. You tasted these things, and you say, Lord, you mean I can have this river of divine glory flowing through me all the time? I don't just have to wait to special meetings. Then you become so desperate for it. You become so longing for it. He lets you taste and says, hey, how do you like it? You go, well, this is amazing, Lord. Yeah. And then he looks at us and sees if we're willing to live days without it. And that's a disappointment if we are willing. But what happens if we're not willing to live with days without it? We're like, oh God, I want that flow. Oh God, I want that flow. Oh God, I want that flow. Oh God, what about me? Oh God, I want that flow. Oh God, I want that flow. I want to understand and move in that flow. I want to understand how to go into the realms of faith with you to where I can always function in that which you've commanded me to be. That's what he's looking for. That's the relationship that we place a demand upon ourselves to have, because Father looks at us. He looks at us being willing to live, be happy with a human existence. He does. And he goes, what? You tasted of my glory. In the goodness of God, in the knowledge of the Lord, he realizes that we just don't get it. He realizes that we don't understand that with faith we can move over into that realm all the time. He understands how we're conflicted with doubt and fear and unbelief. And he's here to make our faith perfect. He's here to make our love fit perfect. He's here to develop us and grow us, but there has to be changes. It's just like the conditions I didn't read to you later on in 1 John chapter 4. after he talks about us living and dwelling and abiding in his love, and this is how our love is made perfect, he says, but if you don't love your brother whom you have seen, if you hate your brother whom you have seen, how can you say you love God whom you've not seen? He's going to bring it down to very practical responses in our life. But I just want you to understand this. I want you to understand this bigger than anything else, because this is the supply by which we do everything that God has purposed us to do. We do not want to live without the flow of heaven, without the glory and the empowerment that comes as we're flooded with the realms of the Holy Spirit. As we're filled with the flood of heaven.